Everybody have a seat. Make yourself comfortable this morning. Well, ladies and gentlemen, a happy Sunday. How many of you feel excited, super excited to be in church this morning? A show of hands. I love that every single hand goes up like that, and that makes me feel excited. So, thanks so much for coming out and being a part of this today. What I want to talk to you about today, with it being New Year time and all that, is I want to talk to you about setting goals. Not just setting goals for the new year. I want to talk to you about setting goals for a lifetime. Now, why is that important? Because the fact is, you're going to go through life either by design or by default, right? Either by design or by default. You're either going to set some goals for yourself and figure out what you want to get out of your life, or somebody else is going to go ahead and set the goals for you. If you don't decide what you want, what you're doing is you're surrendering control of your life. You're abdicating control of your life to someone else or something else. You're not really living, you're just kind of existing. You're reacting, you're coasting through life. And may I remind you that the only way you can be coasting is if you keep going downhill, right? So what am I saying to you today? Whether you're 8 years old or whether you're 80 years old, I want you to custom design your life. Think of it this way. The next time you're in a cemetery, take a look around you. Take a look at all the gravestones in that cemetery. And what you're probably going to see is you'll see a gravestone with a name on it and two dates. The date they were born and the date they die. And in between, you're going to see a dash. Now, the important thing is, what are you going to do during that dash? What are you going to do with your dash? When you think about it, a lot of the big things in life are not within your control. You can't decide where you're going to be born or when you're going to be born. You can't decide who your parents are going to be. You can't really decide exactly when you're going to leave this planet. God knows, you don't know exactly the last day you have. But during that dash, there is a vast amount of things that are totally under your control. So folks, what I want to ask you today is, what are you spending yours on? Are you truly living the dash, knowing who you are and what you want, or are you just kind of dashing to live, running around, spinning your wheels, spending time on things that don't really matter so much to you? Because you know, in the end, maybe it's not so important what you achieve, what you accomplish, what you own, the house, the cash, the cars. It's not how you spend your cash. It's how you spend your dash. That's why the Bible says, teach us to number our days and recognize how few they are. Help us spend them as we should. You know, listen, when I was 24 years old, I really thought a lot about this. I really thought about, you know, I got one life, I told myself. I got one life. What am I going to do with this life that God has given me? And I really prayed about it, and I thought about it, and I wanted to come up with lifetime goals. And I'll tell you what, I wrote down some goals for myself. And I'm going to share those goals with you this morning, because I just want to kind of open my heart up to you. And I'm going to tell you what I wrote 30 years ago. And I'm going to tell you this. I've kept these words posted in my office for the whole 30 years. I never changed a word. I never changed direction. I never veered off course. Now, I haven't lived a perfect life, but I've always aimed in this direction. And after I share this with you, I know that you're going to know who I am at a very deep level, at a very personal level, what kind of drives me and motivates me and makes me tick. So I'm going to share it with you today because I think that you might want to do something like this for your own life. In fact, I would encourage you to personalize these goals and adapt them for yourself. So let's take a look. Here's what I wrote. My lifetime goals. 24 years old, I sat down and wrote, by the grace of God, I will strategically use my life to reach the maximum number of people for Jesus Christ. There is no higher accomplishment than bringing eternal life to another human being. Therefore, I will strategically use my life to bring the maximum number of people possible into a relationship with Jesus Christ. If one individual is welcomed into heaven because of something I have said or done, I will count my life a success. Then number two, I will be God's instrument for building a church for the unchurched. I will allow God to use me to shape a church that will attract the unchurched majority to Jesus Christ. Though the desire of my heart is to leave behind a dynamic congregation, I will serve God in whatever capacity He chooses, be it wielding a broom or filling a pulpit. Then number three, I will build a magnificent marriage and a loving family. I will build a close-knit family filled with love and laughter. My relationship with my wife and children will be second only to my relationship with God. And then finally, number four, I will take hold of the joy and the opportunity in each day God gives me. This is the day the Lord has made. It is a unique gift that will never come my way again. God gave me this day for a purpose. Whether the duties of this day appear important by human standards or trivial, I will recognize that each day is pregnant with possibilities of eternal consequence, rich with opportunities for enjoyment, and packed with people to love. So what do you think? Something like that maybe would work for you? Again, whether you're 8 years old or whether you're 80 years old, I want to give you something to aim for in your life. And I'm just saying maybe you could take something like this and adapt it for yourself. In fact, let me show you how it can work for you. Let's break it down a little bit. Number one, first thing we said was, I will strategically use my life to reach the maximum number of people for Jesus Christ. I said, if just one individual is welcomed into heaven because of something I have said or done, I will count my life a success. Think of it this way. Imagine if you were the greatest individual who ever lived. I mean, ever lived. No one in human history has ever accomplished more than you have accomplished. Nobody's ever amassed more, achieved more. In fact, as a world leader, you brought the entire world peace and prosperity. You won the Nobel Peace Prize repeatedly. You were the greatest individual ever to walk the face of this earth. But guess what? If all you ever did was change this world, all of your accomplishments are eventually going to pass away. All your work will eventually be lost. Your name will eventually be forgotten, because one day this entire world is going to pass away. On the other hand, if you impact the eternal destiny of even one person, you will have made a mark which is eternal. You will have done something with your life. You will have done something that will never be forgotten. I like to put it this way. You will have scratched your initials into the walls of the corridors of eternity. Imagine one day you're up in heaven, you're walking around and all this beauty and radiant light and glory, and someone comes up to you, they put a hand on your shoulder, and as you look at them, you can see the light of glory reflecting in their eyes, and they say this to you: I just want to thank you, because I'm here today because of you. Some of you, maybe they're going to have a big party for you when you get there. All the people, think about it, all the people you have influenced down here during your lifetime, all the people you have prayed for, all the people you have encouraged, they're going to gather around you in heaven and they're going to applaud, they're going to say your name and they're going to cheer. Hey, I don't doubt it, you're going to draw a crowd. But me? I have to say, I'll be happy. I'll count my life a success if even one person is welcomed into heaven because of me. And number two, I said, I want to be God's instrument for building a church for the unchurched. Why is that? Because it is the best way to achieve goal number one. Why is that? It's because it's the best way to reach the maximum number of people possible. It reminds me back years ago in England, they had a tradition. Every single year on Christmas Eve, all the people would gather in the public squares. And they would gather there and they would sing Christmas carols together. And it was a beautiful event. Everybody attended it all year. And as the event ended, the tradition was everybody would divide up and they would go to their own churches. And there in their own churches, they would give gifts to the children. The problem was not everybody had a church. I mean, you'd always, the event would end and everybody would take off and you'd hear somebody say something like, okay, all of you Anglicans, you good Church of England people, come with me. And they would follow him and a whole big crowd of them would leave. Somebody else would say, all the Roman Catholics this way. And they head off in the other direction. Somebody would say, you Baptists, come back to the Baptist church with us. And a group would leave. But at the end, there'd always be a group of people, a large group of people, just milling around, not knowing what to do or where to go. These are the people who had no church. These are the people who didn't know the Lord. These are the people who didn't belong anywhere at all. And at that moment, a young man by the name of William Booth would stand up. He's the founder of the Salvation Army. He would stand up and say, all of you who belong nowhere, all of you have no place to go, all of you who don't know the Lord, you come with us. And they would follow him back to his place. Well, you know what? That's the kind of church that you and I are. That's the kind of church you're in right now. A church that says, all of you, you're welcome here. All of you, we want you to be at home here. All of you, this is the church for you. Now listen, I understand when you make this kind of a goal for your life, some of you are looking at me right now and you're saying, but Jeff, that works for you, but I don't want to be a pastor. You know what? I'm not ever going to be a pastor. I have no desire to be a pastor. So how am I supposed to work on this? Well, friend, you have your part to play. Maybe you're not going to be the guy up here preaching every week, but you're going to be the one manning the ministries, inviting your friends, filling the seats. You're giving and you're praying and you're serving. You're making this a great, vital, vibrant, alive church. It couldn't be what it is today without you. Let me put it to you this way. Whenever you walk through those doors on a Sunday morning and you take your seat there, you are voting yes in favor of this church. You are voting yes in favor of this church. And let me put it to you this way. Whenever you don't come to church, you're voting no. You're voting to close the doors of this church. I say, let's all vote yes every single week. Let's vote yes enthusiastically. Yes, we are for this church with all our heart. Because I want my life to count. Count for eternity. Don't you? Don't you care about that? Let me tell you something else. I'm going to have fun doing it. Because I'm going to be surrounded by love. Surrounded. Number three, I will build a magnificent marriage and a loving family. I want to build a close-knit family filled with love and laughter. Some of you say, well, look, Jeff, I'm not married. Got no intention of ever being married. That ship sailed a long time ago for me. Or listen, I can tell you some stories about my marriage, and it's just not right there where it should be right now. Well, hold on a minute. No matter what's going on in terms of your marriage, your family, you still got people to love in your life. Maybe it's your church family. Maybe it's the people you have coffee with. It's your crowd. It's your circle. But you can still fill your life with love. You can still surround yourself every day with love. And you know what? Let me just speak for myself right now. When I reach the end of my days and I'm lying in a hospital bed someplace, I am not going to say, bring me my stocks and bonds. I want to look at them one more time. I am not going to say, bring me my awards and trophies and diplomas. I just want to hold them one more time. No, I'll tell you what I'm going to say. Bring me my kids. because I want to see him one more time. Bring me my wife, because I want to try to tell her what she has meant to me. And what am I saying to you today? Why wait until you reach the end of your life to start living for what's really important? I mean, of course, I want you to work hard. I want you to climb that ladder in life. But what I'm saying is this. Make sure that ladder is leaning up against the right wall. Make sure you don't spend your life climbing the ladder only to get to the top and find out that ladder's been leaning against the wrong wall the whole time. Because I'll tell you, the faster you climb up that ladder, the higher you go every step of the way. If it's not leaning against the right wall, you're just getting to the wrong place quicker. Folks, let me tell you something. I'm going to travel through this life with love surrounding me, and I'm going to soak up all the simple blessings in each and every day. Number four, I will take hold of the joy and opportunity in each day God gives me. This is the day the Lord has made. It is a unique gift that will never come my way again. I heard about three guys who were having one of these big, deep talks about life. And these three guys said, you know what? Think about this. When you reach the end of your life and you're in a casket someplace, and all of your friends and all of your family, they gather around and they start talking about you and they're mourning you and they're honoring you, what do you want them to say about you? They all thought about that. First guy says, you know, I hope they say that I was one of the great doctors of my generation. Second guy says, I hope they say that I was a wonderful school teacher who impacted lots of lives. Third guy says, I hope I hear them say, look, he's moving. What I'm saying is, why wait until you reach the end to wish you could have another day? Live right now. Live clear-eyed and fully present in each day. Folks, stop acting like this is a dress rehearsal. Live this very day as if it is your last. Shake yourself awake each day. Let the winds of enthusiasm blow through you. Live today with gusto. Someone once said, life should not be a journey to the grave with the intention of arriving safely in an attractive and well-preserved body, but rather to skid in sideways, chocolate in one hand, martini or cappuccino in the other, body thoroughly used up, totally worn out, and screaming, woo-hoo, what a ride. Maybe you're thinking, my goodness, I never heard a preacher talk like that in church before. Well, my goodness, maybe if more preachers talked like that in church, we'd have more churches full of happy, healthy, holy people. And my goodness, when someone asks you, how was church this week? I want you to say, woo-hoo, what a ride. So folks, bottom line, I want you to set lifetime goals. I want you to know what direction you're aiming. You don't have to start from scratch. Copy mine. Adapt to them. Adopt them. Because I want you to make the very most of this one life that God has given you. So let's bow our heads now and pray together. And why don't you let me lead you in this prayer? Maybe you'd like to say something like this. Heavenly Father, hello, it's me. You know, old Jeff King doesn't seem all that smart, but he sure seems to live a full, fun, joy-packed life. And it is a life of meaning and lasting eternal significance. Help me live like that. If old Jeff can do it, for sure I can. So, Father, there's still time. Help me clarify what I want to get out of this one life that I have. What's important? Because I want to live my life by design, not by default. I want my life to count. I want my life to matter. And if I'm going to be climbing the ladder of success, help me be sure the ladder is leaning against the right wall. May my life bring glory and honor to you, Lord. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. And now we pray together in unison those words that Jesus taught. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.